மாலாசுதாம் கும்ப விபோத முத்ரா வித்யாவிராஜத கரவாரி ஜாதாம் அபார காருண்ய சுதாம்புராஷிம் ஸ்ரீ சாரதாம்பா பிரணதோஸ்மி நித்யம். சீக்கிங் பெனிடிக்ஷன் ஃப்ரம் ஜெகன்மாதா சாரதா பரமேஸ்வரி, தட் ரெபாசிட்ரி ஆஃப் ஆல் தட் இஸ் கல்ச்சர், நாலேஜ், ட்ரெடிஷன், விஸ்டம், ஆர்ட், லேர்னிங் அண்ட் ஃபைன் ஆர்ட், ஐ போ டு வேர் அஸ் ஐ கமென்ஸ் மை அட்ரஸ் டுடே. இட் கிவ்ஸ் மீ கிரேட் பிளஷர் டு வெல்கம் யூ ஆல் டு திஸ் பிளசன்ட் சாலம் அண்ட் யூனிக் ஃபங்க்ஷன் organized this evening to honor men of caliber who have stood guard and continue to exercise vigil to uphold the values of democracy and other cherished and connected cardinal values that have been enshrined into the constitution by its makers. The elections to the 16th Lok Sabha, which we witnessed recently, was preceded by hectic electioneering for several months. There were occasions when it had degenerated to levels which were not conducive and worthy of a matured democracy. Internal bickerings within a political party or within the parties, interstate between the parties, and with the election commission as it exercised its superintendent's role over the electoral process in the country, thankfully has come to an end. Mercifully, the 16th Lok Sabha has been constituted. People have given a very decisive mandate. The era of coalition politics, at least for the time being, has gone to the back burner. The pulls and the pushes of the regional forces to have local issues getting dominance and precedence over national priorities, also for the time being, are back to the back seats, and the nation can address itself to those genuine priorities that would ultimately bring welfare to its subjects. The dust and the din of the elections have settled. The cacophony of voices have stilled. It is usual business in the election commission. They have girded up their loins and preparing themselves for election to the state assemblies of Maharashtra, Jharkhand, Haryana, Jammu and Kashmir, and possibly New Delhi. It is business as usual as far as the government of India is concerned, with the new agenda being set by the new government. In the meanwhile, the election commission can be legitimately be proud of its contribution over the last 5 decades for nurturing and blossoming democracy in this country through the electoral process. To elect 543 members to the Lok Sabha from a constituency of 81.45 crore voters, exercising their franchise over 9 lakh polling booths spread across the country, is no mean task. Working under extreme conditions which are a deterrent to the basic of election system all over the world, the dominance of money and muscle power and mafia, of the influence of religion and caste in the inclusion of voters, voter intimidation, booth capturing, which has come down substantially over the years. Despite all these facts, the election commission over the last 5 decades has stood ground, asserted itself, and generously used the various rights that have been conferred onto the commission by the makers of the constitution. And it is because of this action of the election commission, not only to bring reforms within the various administrative procedures that is adopting in conducting the elections, and thanks to various pragmatic parliaments in the past which had worked with the election commission to bring about various reforms which ultimately will bring about a level playing field. These alterations over the years have been ample and venerable, and it is these that have brought about even-handedness in the election system in the country and a free and a fair process of election by which the most meritorious as the people who decide can get elected. But there is still a long, long way to go. There is so much to be done to cleanse the system, but there is no gainsay from the fact that the election commission over the years has done a stupendous task of ensuring fairness in election systems in this country. The contribution of succeeding election commissioners and the team that comprise of the election commission is more said in words than in deeds. There is a general perception that the contribution of the commission has not been recognized adequately. Even the national civil honors that are conferred these days are confined more for celebrities, politicians, and recommendations of the political masters. But the grateful society of this country has ever been conscious of the fact and the need to recognize, honor, acknowledge the contribution of the Election Commission. Institutions like ours, like several other institutions all over the country, are the voice of the common public, the common Indian that we are. We mirror the aspirations and expectations of the people, and this function that is being held today is a step in that direction. However symbolic this function may appear to be, it's a genuine appreciation, regard, reverence, and admiration for the successive teams of election commissioners that free India had seen post-independence who have guided the election system in this country. There is a general myth and perception that democracy and election systems had come to India from the West. The facts are entirely to the contrary. Right from the times immemorial, the kings have ruled the kingdoms, providing enough space to recognize and accept the voice of the people. The Vedas are testimony to this. The Vedas contain reference to three institutions, Sabha, Samitis, and Adatas, referred to in the Vedas, which are the basis of any democracy. The Rudram, which appears in the Yajurveda, speaks about Sabhas and Samitis. The Pancharudram, which comes in the Rig Veda, speaks about the qualities of the Savayan, that he should be fair, he should be articulate, he should be educated. At the concluding portion of the Rig Veda, there is a verse which speaks about how decisions have to be taken by the Sabhas and the Savayans, collective responsibility, and how ultimately the decision should be taken in a unified manner for the welfare of the people. The first recorded evidence of electoral system in this country dates back to the 2nd and the 3rd century BC. The first edicts were taken in a place called as Uttarameruvar in the Kanchipuram district of Tamil Nadu. The archival extractions that have been brought about speak of stone epigraphs which themselves were dated 920 AD, 1000 years before, pertaining to the election system in the 2nd and the 3rd century BC. The Sangamam period, the celebrated period of the Dravidian rule in this country, spoke about the creation of the present Tamil Nadu and three dominant kingdoms that existed, the Cheras, the Cholas, and the Pandians, who ruled different parts of that land. The Cholas were known for their administrative skills, of their efficiency to manage their kingdoms, and the justice that the king meted out to every one of his subjects. It was during the time of Parantaka Cholan, in the early part of the 3rd century BC, that he conceived for the first time a voice for the general public and brought about an election system. The entire Chola kingdom was divided into various units, and these units were further divided into Vayanads, each Vayanads representing 16 localities. From the Vayanads came the Kutrams, from the Kutrams the Kotam, and from the Kotam to the Oor. Oor means a village. The lowest denominator of the hierarchy was the village from where the election built up used to take place. During those days, there was this Achar Sahita that we are talking about now, the election code. Such a code existed even then. The qualifications for a person to stand for any of the elections to the various samitis, the sabhas or the adats, was, number one, he should own at least a quarter veli of land. Veli is an unit of measurement of land, and quarter veli is a very small unit of measurement. That if a person did not possess land of his own, and a land on which taxes are paid by him, the land which is given as manyam or as gift by the government is not eligible for that person to stand for elections. Number two, he should have built his own house on that land. And the third thing is, he should have been at least 35 years of age and should not have crossed 70 years of age. The fourth thing is, he had not amassed any wealth or properties by any unfair means. He should have been educated, should have reasonable understanding of the dharmic values of life. And those days in the Chola dynasty, the elections were held every year. And if a person were to stand and win an election, there is a cooling period for 3 years. And he becomes re-eligible for standing for elections only in the fourth year after the year he gets selected. And lastly, there was a condition which said, if the assembly were already to have any one of his relatives, and the relatives were defined, then even if he gets elected, he is disqualified from becoming a Sabayan. Tell me, my dear friends, whatever electoral reforms that we are craving for which we are all shouting from rooftops, are they any different from the ones that are placed over here? If they existed in ancient India, why should they not be part of the electoral system today? Because these are legitimate expectations of people in a democracy. Around the same time, a few years later, into the 3rd century BC, came the golden age of the Gupta Empire. Chanakya, Vishnu Gupta, wrote that magnum opus, Arthashastra. Arthashastra is not only on fiscal policies, it was on all actions of the state. And Chanakya defined the contours of how a state is to be administered, including the electoral process, which also existed in the Gupta period. And he said, Praja suke sukam ragyaha prajnanam cha ite itam na atma priyam suke ragyaha prajanam tu priyam hitam. In the welfare of the people lies the welfare of the king. In their happiness lies his happiness. If there is anything that does not please the subjects, it should not please the king. He should consider it as beneficial to him, whatever pleases the subject. The core, the central message of Chanakya's edict as far as the electoral process was concerned was basically that it should be ultimately beneficial to the people. When we look at the size of the electorate, we understand how valuable our election commissioners are. Not easy and ordinary persons can occupy the chairs that these people had occupied during their lifetime. An ordinary head and a shoulder will be a misfit for the job that demands of them the highest of professional integrity and action. They should be fiercely competitive in their mind. They should be friendly and above all professionally competent to discharge the responsibilities of the members, the multi-member members of the election commission of this country, as large and diversified as Gayatri Narayan said at the beginning of the welcome address. Ever since Mr. T. N. Seshan energized the election commission, the succeeding election commissioners, most of whom are all present over today, carried on the torch that was lit and redefined the electoral process in this country. For once they sent shivers down the spines of politicians, erring as they were and getting into the wrong track. And that is the greatness of these people who are present over today. The galaxy of people who are present over today, whom we are honoring today, deserve not just to be honored, but much beyond that. Honor and shame from no condition arise. Act well your part, therein the honor lies, says Pope John Paul VI. These people have acted their part very well. It is one thing to deserve an honor and not having it. Dignity lies not in possessing an honor, but deserving an honor. No one has ever been honored in this earth for what he has received, but essentially for what he has given. These people are not anchored for these awards. They have not run beyond people, sabhas and samitis to get acknowledgement for their contribution. They have not even queued up before the corridors of power asking for gubernatorial posts or for that matter, civilian honors to be conferred on them. But the grateful society, as I said at the beginning, has always understood that they have not been honored adequately. And today, we are honoring them and in the process, honoring ourselves. Our shower of encomiums, our garlands, our mementos and bouquets certainly are not honors. Only if election after election we go and exercise our franchise, that would not only be a tribute to democracy, but that would be the true felicitation to all these people who have served all their life for the cause of electioneering in this country. The Greek word idiot means one who does not vote. Certainly, these people deserve to be honored by people who are not idiots. Both the Shanmukananda Fine Arts and Sangeeta Sabha and the South Indian Education Society have gone beyond their stated objectives. The canvas of their activity, the sweep of their influence, the various areas into which they have gone, representing almost all facets of life and human endeavor. And over the year, the various programs that have been conducted in this auditorium is ample testimony as to how we have redefined culture, we have redefined education in the country. But there are still doubting Thomases. Thomases who wonder, what has a cultural institution to do with the election commission? I want to tell you today There is so much to do with the election commission as far as culture of the land is concerned. And it is not strange or coincidence that each one of them have deep and abiding interest in music. Chitti and Seshan is a connoisseur of music. His understanding of Carnatic music and the nuances of music are legendary. People who know Gopal Swami will tell me that he is not only a student of music, he is a commoner as far as all concerts are concerned, as far as the December festival is concerned. As far as Mr. T.S. Krishnamurthy is concerned, music is homegrown. His wife is an accomplished veena player of national repute. So he can't divorce himself from music, and therefore he has lived with music in his house, and that too of an instrument which is a divine instrument. And what to speak of Mr. Qureshi? He is adept in the keyboard, and in the recent years he has become very proficient as far as the guitar is concerned. And the band that he has, the rock band that he has got at Delhi, has a very interesting combination. It has Madhukar Gupta, the former Home Secretary, as the drumist. Shiv Shankar Menon, the former National Security Advisor, is the vocalist available for his band. And the additional vocal solo will come from Nirupama, the former ambassador to US. So it runs deep in them. And today Neela Satyanarayana could not come. As she was coming for this function, the state election commissioner, I don't know, she had a bout of vomiting and she had to be taken back, and immediately the doctor brought in. And she was a trustee of this institution representing the government of Maharashtra for a long time, and she is the present election commissioner of Maharashtra. So therefore you will understand that we are celebrating not only India, celebrating not only democracy of the people who have contributed to the success of the electoral process in this country. In a small way, we are also celebrating their contribution and their family's contribution to the cause of fine arts in this country. The three basic ills that plague the election system in this country, to which I made a reference at the beginning, are essentially money, mafia, and muscle power. There are four more C's which come in. One is corruption, second is criminalization, third is casteism, and fourth is communalism. Students of science will bear me out to say, when M and C were to come together, Einsteinian theory of energy will be produced positively, E equal to MC squared. But this cocktail of M and C, 3M and 4C in the election system, is a deadly cocktail. It finishes the election system in the country. And therefore, time has come for us to assert and exercise our public opinion and ensure that the governments of the day respond to this basic need of cleansing the election system. And I'm sure these persons will also put in their pressure on the new government. In fact, everything new sweeps well, every broom sweeps well. But unfortunately, even this metaphor we cannot give these days, because the election commission has assigned that broom also to the Aam Aadmi Party. So I have to look for some new metaphors to tell you how new governments function very well, at least for the time being. And therefore, I believe that if we can put in the right type of pressure and sustained momentum on public opinion, it's possible that the electoral reforms will see the light of the day. And if these people can see it during their lifetime, that would be the greatest tribute to the work that they have done to strengthen the election system in this country. And I think that would be the greatest honor that we will be giving to them. We are beholden to our Honorable Governor, Shri K. Shankar Narayanan. Unfailingly, for any invitation that we extend to him, there is no rejection for us. He says, I am always willing to come to this institution. He adds the grace and the luster of every program that we conduct here. We are thankful to you, sir, for your gracious presence again today. As I come to the end of my address, I think my memories go back to Atal Bihari Vajpayee. Those immortal verses that he wrote, and one of them I can take and tell you today. Ahuti baki yajna yadura, apno ko vigno se gera, antim jai ki vrajya banaye, naye dadichi adhya uraye, aavo fir se diya jalaye, aavo fir se diya jalaye. Let us light that lamp of hope again, that lamp that ushers in the second freedom, as he said, other than the first freedom that our forefathers got for us in 1947. That lamp that will have the panchamukhi, of which at least one wick shall be lit for electoral reforms in the country. May the good Lord shed his grace on all of them so that they live long and achieve the purposes of their life. May he also shed his grace on us so that we can draw a leaf from the lives of nobility of these men and make our own lives sublime. Thank you and God bless you, sir.